Hey, welcome back. I wanted to bring you to another article I found in regards to manufacturing and I believe lack thereof. This is, as you can see, titled 40 Years of Falling Manufacturing Employment. Let's see, by Kathleen Harris, I believe. Despite being a leading driver of employment growth for decades, manufacturing has shed employment over the past 40 years as U.S. economy has shifted to service-providing industries. In June of 79, manufacturing employment reached an all-time peak of 19.6 million. In June of 2019, employment was at 12.8 million, down 6.7 million, or 35%, from all-time peak. And since 1979, employment fell during each of the five recessions, and in each case, employment never fully recovered to pre-recession levels. This Beyond the Number article looks at the broad employment trends in manufacturing over the past 40 years, as well as the trends in specific industries that have been most affected, such as fabricated metals and machinery and computer electrical products and apparel and textile industries. Data are from the U.S. Bureau of Labor Statistics, currently employment statistic, whatever, anyway, see, anyway, so CES program. Steady cyclical growth, 1939 to 19 or 79, which I believe is business cycle, or maybe it was pro cyclical. Anyways, during a 40-year build up to the June 1979 peak, manufacturing employment experienced steady but cyclical growth, omitting the industrialization that occurred during World War II. We find that manufacturing's share of total non-farm employment peaked in May of 53 at 32%. After World War II, employment declined with each recession, but then rebounded during each recovery. In the 1960s, manufacturing employment growth accelerated. From February of 61 to August of 69, manufacturing added 4 million jobs, a 27% increase. Two recessions during the 1970s saw manufacturing lose 1.5 million and 2 million jobs, respectively, excuse me, with the recovery period in between. During the period of expansion from July of 1975 through June of 79, manufacturing added 3 million jobs, and employment in the industry stood at 19.6 million. Now, according to the graph, this is until 2018, you can see there's a sharp downward between 2002 and until 2010. That's at least 8 years, and that's before the GFC, Great Financial Recession, or anyway, declines after 79, at its peak in June of 2000, sorry, 2000, of 1979, manufacturing employment represented 22% of total non-farm employment, but that share had fallen to 9% in June of 2019. Manufacturing's falling share of employment coincided, there we go, with job growth in service-provided industries, including professional and business services, education and health services, and leisure and hospitality. Now, let's see. Total non-farm employment for 79 was 90,108. Employment was 150,759, and changes of employment was 60,651. Manufacturing was 19,553. Percentage of non-farm employment was 22,000. Employment was 12,838. Percentage of total non-farm employment, 9,000. changes of employment minus 6,715. Percentage in changes of non-farm employment was minus 13,000. Durable goods, 12,320 of employment. Non-farm employment was 14,000. Employment was 8,064. This would be change. It would be minus 4,256. So it goes down, goes up slightly. These are different things. Excuse me. Let's see. Okay, yeah. So on the far right, change of percentage. The most was in manufacturing, which was minus 13, from what I could see. Then minus 8, minus 5, minus 1, no changes. Minus 2, minus 1, 0, 6, 8, 4, and 1, and minus 3. So there's been no real robust change or upswing in manufacturing of any kind as far as this part goes. Let's see, financial industry. Yeah, okay. Let's see, durable and non-durable goods. And by June of 2019, manufacturers of both durable goods and non-durable goods lost more than one-third of jobs held in 79. Employment in durable goods fell by 4.3 million, while non-durable goods lost 2.5 million jobs over the 40-year span. Employment in durable goods has been more sensitive to recession than in non-durable goods. Durable goods industry lost an average of 10% of jobs throughout each recession. So basically, in each recession, there's more and more job losses. And guess what? That also means more, less wages. So the pay wage or the wage discrepancy goes up a lot by that time because a lot of those corporations are not fucking going out of business. They're giving more work for other people, and those other people are not getting raises. They're just doing more work for the same pay. I've experienced that just like I know you have. Anyway, so let's see. Durable goods industry also served as a good indicator that a recession was looming. With the exception of the recession in the early 1980s, durable goods employment reached a peak at 6 months before the beginning of a recession. After each recession, durable goods employment never quite recovered before turning down again. After both recessions in the 1980s, only about half of the lost jobs returned. During the recession in 1990, durable goods experienced a long downturn, employment reaching at peak 19 months before the recession began. It did not turn up again until 28 months after the recession ended. Durable goods lost 2 million jobs in both 2001 and 2007 recessions. However, since February 2010, durable goods has experienced consistent growth and has recovered 1 million jobs of the ones like 3 or 4 million jobs it once had in it. 1 million jobs of June 2019. Employment in non-durable goods has been much less cyclical and has experienced a general long-term downward trend that started in the mid-90s, continue until reaching a trough in December of 2011. On average, non-durable goods lost 5% of employment during each recession. By June 2019, non-durable goods have recovered 340,000 jobs since its most recent employment trough. Combining industry to analysis, most CES employment series for manufacturing industry did not extend back to 1979 using the current industry coding structure. From 79 and 90, CES classified data during standard industrial classifications or SIC based system. Since 1990, CESS has classified data using the National American Industrial Classification System, or NAICS, to best represent 40 years of history by industry. Employment from one or more industries was subtracted to create the employment series analysis. In this article, Exhibit 1 shows durable goods industry developed for a 40-year analysis to create the series for wood products and furniture from 79 to 90. Some employment for lumber and wood products are SIC 24, and furniture and fixtures are SIC 25. Then subtract this time. Employment for lodging, which was removed from manufacturing with the conversion to NAICS, to represent the series from 1990 to 2019, so 29 years, looks like. Some employment for wood production, furniture related products. In some instances, the development of 40-year history uses employment from one SIC series and from one NAICS series, because limited industry reclassification occurred. For example, non-metallic mineral products and compost of stone, clay, and glass products. Long and short of this is because of lack of manufacturing, prices go up. As far as groceries, furniture, as you can see, and stuff of that nature, is not MMT, is not anything other than that. Interest rates, cheap things more expensive. When they bring up interest rates, they basically are trying to stifle the loan out process, the credit, making everything more expensive to take out as far as credit and any kind of loans. It's not working out. It hasn't been working out since they started with the interest rates. Because the demand for cash, demand for credit will always be there until people have such a wage increase that they are not needing credit of any kind. So the interest rates are only proving that MMT has been correct on interest rates, and that interest rates are an extra cost of all goods and services. Bottom line is, interest rates, I don't care what party you're in, should be held at zero, because that, since interest rates are meant to be a price setter within the economy, if it's at zero and we are at full employment, that's when you most likely have balanced price stability. When you have Green New Deal and you have renewable energy, such as wind and solar, that brings cost of energy down because you're not using excessive amounts of natural resources that come out of the ground that tend to be more expensive to produce and manufacture. So those savings goes back into people's pockets. Job guarantee is deflationary. So is Green New Deal. So is Medicare for All. If you have private sector union jobs that are predicated on the amount that your boss pays on your insurance, health insurance, if there's a Medicare for All healthcare system put in place, single payer, that takes the healthcare insurance out of the boss's control and more than likely gives you a wage hike, since majority of the health care is the wage you pay as well. In other words, the more you get paid, the higher your health care goes. If it's single payer health care, that means that the higher your wages go, the less you have to do crap for your boss who puts the health care over your head. And a job guarantee is for those who want to work but can't find work in the private sector. That's the deal as far as that part goes. None of which MMT policy are inflationary. It's all meant to be deflationary because they compare doing that to not doing that, which is inherently more costly. Be right back.